From the heart of Silicon Valley in California, this is Plug-In 2008, and you've got an exclusive press pass.
You know, as often happens when, at least if you're me, when you're coming to an event, you're in a plane, you're in a car, and you're jotting notes about what's on your mind and what you're thinking, and somehow fate has a way of smacking you upside the head and sort of changing what you're thinking at the time. You can call it coincidence or whatever, but I had one of those experiences this morning. I got off the plane and I walked out to get a cab 4.5 miles to here. And I got one sitting there at the curb, and it was a Prius. And as I rode in, I made a note to myself here, watching the digital control panel on the dash, that we were getting 41.7 miles to the gallon coming here. Can you even imagine that having happened 5 years ago? Is it even in our comprehension that a taxi cab would be a hybrid, that it would get almost 42 miles to the gallon, and that people were happy to ride in it? I thought, wow, isn't this cool? I'm in a Prius going to this conference. Rather than saying, well, I wanted the Lincoln Town Car, emissions be damned, right? So our way of thinking has changed. And I suppose that having passed the half-century mark myself has given me the entitlement to have some historical perspective. I think as you get older, and as my daughters would say, more boring, you talk about the good old days an awful lot more. And I think it struck me this morning as I was jotting my notes that we mark our lives a lot of times by these very special confluences in history that someone smarter than me called tipping points, right? When great forces all converge to cause a genuine shift, a change in paradigm that changes the world, not for that day, but forever. And I can think of a small handful of tipping point events in my lifetime. One of them, of course, was the landing of men on the moon and how it changed the entire world in ways we never could have expected. Not because we landed on the moon, but because we had to invent computers. Because really the digital era came from those efforts. All of the things that were spawned, it was truly a tipping point event. The other one that struck me this morning that I'll never ever forget was the fall of the Soviet Union. Right, I'll always remember sitting glued to my TV screen as people sang and candles burned and the wall fell. After decades of coalescence around diverse ideas, some of which were as silly as you remember mutually assured destruction, that was a notion that was promulgated by politicians under which we're all to take great satisfaction in knowing that as their nuclear warheads sped towards us, ours would pass them in the air and that would make it okay. But finally, after decades, the forces of moral righteousness and the power of human thought reached a critical mass. And I remember thinking that very night that I had just witnessed something that men would write about and talk about for 1,000 years. Now here's the cool part. I'm of the view that on this day and in this place, we are witnessing a tipping point. That's pretty powerful. After decades of, again, diverse and siloed ideas, and some of them pretty crazy, we're part of a convergence that I believe will almost certainly change the world forever. If you look around this room, and I had the chance to meet some of you, not enough, but some, what a strange bunch of bedfellows. Right? Zealots, early adopters, Greens, CFOs, bankers, corporate behemoths, electric utility people, all coming together driven by the force of a vision and a commitment to sustainability, efficiency, environmental stewardship that are part and parcel of this conference and are becoming part of the global fabric. And things, I believe, will never be the same. Just before we came up to this podium, I was talking to a reporter from the, I hope I get this right, Matt, San Jose Mercury News. And I said that one of the things that had struck me about the work that we are all embarked on is how many people have changed their basic mindset about the world around them. My wife is one. Now, my wife is an incredible lady and very bright, but she has absolutely no interest in all the years we've been married in anything sort of green or environmental or efficient. So we had what I called the light bulb wars in my house, where she has a chair and a reading lamp, and I would come home with the latest CFL whatever, and I'd screw it into her reading lamp, and it would use 13 watts instead of her 100, and I would come home the next day, and it would be gone, and the incandescent bulb would be in. And I'd say, where'd my cool bulb go? And she'd say, I hate that crap you bring home. The light's no good. Well, this went on for months. And finally, one day, one of our Edison researchers said, try this one. It's amazing. I screwed it in. A day went by. A week went by. And then, pressing my luck, I said, you know, I put a cool bulb in there. She said, yeah, I know. I said, well, why didn't you take it out? She said, because it works just like the old one. Isn't that the key to the whole thing? That it works just like the old one? And my wife now says, I don't want to trade my old car in because I want to wait and get one of them plug ones because they'll be better. And she's right, they will be. Right? That's the way she's thinking. She doesn't want to look, any of the cars I suggested, she doesn't want to look at because she's waiting for those. And a lot of people here are waiting for those, right? And they will come. And people will adapt and adopt, and we will see the world changed. And I think it's amazing. So that was just a note I wrote to myself. Now, those of us in the electric utility business, we're fortunate to be part of this equation and part of the solution that you've been discussing at this conference. And you've heard some details about our future vision, and I won't stay up a long time and bore you. But if you think about it, it's somehow profoundly appropriate that we need you and you need us if you're in the auto business, the battery business, and so forth. Because if you think of the two things that have probably most significantly shaped American life and prosperity over the last century, wouldn't it be electricity and the automobile? I mean, isn't that the fabric of everything we've done in America? And I think it's incredibly appropriate that together we get the chance to reshape American life again. And that's what's happening here. Now, there are a great many ideas about the next generation of vehicles and how they might work with the electric grid in new ways, and we're excited about all of them. Things like vehicle-to-grid applications, but they aren't what I'm focused on day to day. We have smart people thinking about them and working with all of you, but I'm more concerned about how our business doesn't let down this vision, how we, as a provider and enabler, are capable of efficiently allowing our customers to convert to this technology, which is more sensible, more efficient, far more green. And if we can't provide our part of the solution, we'll stall the whole process. And my belief is that, and you've heard some of this from some of our other folks at this conference, my belief is that in order to efficiently enable this and many other changes that will affect the world, involving alternative and renewable energy and reducing carbon footprint, we've got to change the way we do business as profoundly, although much more subtly and less visibly to all of you, as profoundly as automakers have. We need a smarter grid to enable this future. Because right now our grid, although it's a marvel, it's a marvel of engineering and human ingenuity, to have what we have here, to have electricity everywhere in America and the things we can do with it, our grid is not very smart. Works, but it's pretty dumb. A note to myself, I said that with no disrespect to any of my colleagues in the auto industry or from any particular company, but our electric grid today is a K car. Right? Do you remember the K car? Those of you who are at least my age, Tom's nodding his head. Well, I had a K car. I had a white K car, which my wife called, she nicknamed it the POS. You can figure out what that stood for. And yes, the P stands for pile. Now, on the one hand, it got me from here to there, at least most of the time, but it wasn't efficient. It wasn't nearly as reliable or safe as we now expect vehicles to be. It didn't offer me many choices or options. It did have an 8-track player, but I added that. Well, our grid is sort of the same way. If you think about it right now, we have a principally unidirectional relationship with our customers. Without asking us or without knowing what the impacts are on the world, not just on us, you do stuff. You flip a switch. You plug something in, eventually a vehicle. And you assume that it will work, right? And actually, a miraculous series of events are required to make it work. Because where else, if you think about our business, where else is there a business in the world that's marked by the characteristics of ours? And what are the characteristics I'm referring to? Think about it. We instantaneously match supply and demand 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in real time with a product that can't be inventoried. Now, when my wife gets on the internet, one of the things she's hooked on now, I tell a lot of stories about my dear wife, she's hooked on internet shopping. Any of you love that? Right? Amazon.com or Barnes & Noble or Eddie Bauer. And she is continuously astounded by the fact that she can order a cable knit sweater from Eddie Bauer online, pay for it with a keystroke, and 3 days later it arrives at our door. And she sees this as an amazing breakthrough in mankind. And it really is. Now imagine a paradigm where you walked up to the wall in your home and you flipped the switch and 3 days later the lights came on. Or even 3 minutes. You'd go crazy, right? I mean, our expectations for the provision of electricity are that it will always be there when you want it. But unlike Barnes & Noble or Amazon.com, we can't inventory the product. There has never been, in the 150 years of our business, an efficient way to store large quantities of our product. Some would argue that pump storage hydroelectric serves that purpose, although that's a very specialized application. We have very little of it in California because we don't have the topography or the water. But you think about the fact that we basically are in a situation where when you ask for it, we make it for you to order. That's how the electric utility business works. We make it for you when you want it. Now, the implication for us, particularly as we integrate more and more alternative and renewable resources, particularly in California. Southern California Edison has the highest penetration of all alternative and renewable resources in California. California, in turn, has the highest penetration in the United States. We're at 16 or 17% of your power being supplied by clean alternative resources now, headed towards a goal of 20% in 2010, and the state legislature is talking about 33% somewhere around 2020. We buy 10% of the wind in the country. We buy 90% of the solar power in the country. We've just announced a project. Tom was talking about 50,000 square feet. Well, we're going to beat that just in solar. We've just announced a project where we're going to install 2 square miles of photovoltaic cells on the top of big distribution warehouses to get 250 megawatts of production from solar. Nobody's ever looked at numbers that big before, and we're going to do that. But as we integrate all of this alternative and renewable power, which is fundamentally clean but also fundamentally intermittent, we now have to balance it against your needs. We'll still have fossil plants for a long time because you're not willing to wait until the sun shines or the wind blows when you flip your wall switch. If you were, everything would be happy. What's the connection between all of that? That our grid's got to be smarter to constantly balance. And we have to engage now in a two-way conversation with customers. Can't be one way anymore. Now we have to know what you want and how you want it, and you have to know what the impacts of that are on our grid and hopefully participate with us in options, like a determination that you'll charge your plug hybrid vehicle at night when we have excess capacity and costs are low, and we don't have to turn on fossil fuel plants to serve you. So if the wind's blowing at night, maybe we can charge your vehicle from the wind and not have to fire up a combustion turbine during the day burning dirty fuel because you want your vehicle charged. How do we do that? We do that by interacting with you, by giving you information. Some of it will be pricing signals. People are irrational, and if it's cheaper, you'll tell your home energy system to charge your vehicle between certain hours. The other way is to give you information about your impact on the world, so that just by pure moral suasion, you'll say, well, the right thing for me to do is plug it in at night. And in order to do all of this, you have to become part of the smart grid as consumers. Now, we're taking one important step at Southern California Edison over the next 3 or 4 years. We're going to install 5 million smart connect meters. You may have heard about that from other speakers. It's a breakthrough. These are the smartest meters ever installed. We're going to give them to every one of our customers, and they will enable two-way communication between us and the customer. And I don't like the term meter because it really understates what we're doing. What we're really doing is giving every customer on the wall of your home will be a powerful computer and communication system. And one of the things it does is meter your electricity. It's only one of them. And that will also be a node that enables your home network, your computer, to communicate with us and obtain information about what you're doing in your home. And manufacturers are already equipping their appliances with chips to communicate with the meter in your home network. My wife just had us buy a new washer and dryer the other day. And I, of course, being, well, my kids call me Lord of the Nerds, had to take the back off it, which is not recommended, by the way. It probably voids the warranty. But this manufacturer, who I won't name, has already equipped their washers and dryers with the communicating chips. They're just not turned on. But they're in there. So that we'll be able to communicate on our network with our washer and dryer. And I believe that very soon in the future, you'll be able to walk into your local Walmart or Target, and you'll have a variety of programs you'll be able to pick up that will cost very little. In fact, some of them may be giveaways, that you'll plug in your computer and your home energy wizard will turn itself on and start asking you simple questions about your lifestyle, your commitment to reducing greenhouse gases, the kind of vehicles you drive. When do you want your security lights on? When do you like to do your wash? Would you like me to stop your washer from going on before 7 p.m. to save you money? Would you like me to control your irrigation sprinklers? Would you like me to control when your plug hybrid charges? Would you like to participate in your utilities program to enable us to someday use your plug hybrid as a backup energy source? All of that will be part of the choice that you have over your energy future and your carbon footprint. And I think we'll see it in the next few years. That's going to be exciting. The other thing that's going to be exciting is that the work that all of you are doing on plug hybrids on electric vehicles, of course, is leading to this incredible concentration of brain power on the issue of energy storage. And if you can store it in a car, and you can do it with high density, high safety, flexibility, form factor, then we can store it in your garage. And I believe that the technology breakthroughs that are happening here will enable us to do the battery in a box, as we call it, where I think that, I'm going to make a prediction, that in the next decade, when you buy a new home, you will consider having battery storage neatly tucked away in the garage as common and ordinary as having a water heater. And that will enable the integration of both distributed, alternative and renewable resources, and enable us to give you more choices about how you control your bill and your carbon footprint. I went and saw a test house the other day that had both, it had several things. It had a thermal hot water system mounted on the roof. It had photovoltaic cells on the roof. And it had a small and silent windmill in the backyard. And all of this was enabled by a digital control system and battery storage in the garage. And it was quite an amazing thing to see. Now, I think honesty forces me to reveal that I had to go to Bermuda to see it, which was tough duty. But somebody had to do it, so I did it. But it's there and it's working. And I think the technology that we're dealing with here will enable us to continue this advancement towards a smart grid, which will give you the choices. It will let us be a good partner in the development of the plug hybrid and where appropriate, the fully electric vehicle, so that we don't serve as a roadblock. And most important, it will make the world better for all of us and for our kids. So this is an incredible, incredible time. And go home and tell your kids, I'm the tipping point, because today you are. So enough said for today. Thank you.